Hi all, welcome to Smart Catalyst, 18th February 2019. Today we'll be discussing these five topics. First one is related with the black buck deer's fight for existence in Punjab. The second is related with the policy bias against rainfed agriculture in India. The third is related with the recent interview of 15th Finance Commission Chairman. The fourth one is about India being a digitally mature economy. The fifth is about India's effort to isolate Pakistan in SAARC. This article speaks about the threats being faced by the black buck deer in the state of Punjab. Black buck deer is a state animal of Punjab, Haryana and Andhra Pradesh. And we will discuss about the threats being faced by the black buck in those states. Black buck is a state animal of Punjab. And a recent report by the Punjab state government has indicated that in the year 2018, as many as 25 black bucks have died. And they have cited the issue of stray dogs, that is a feral dogs in the neighborhoods, and barbed cobra wire. These black bucks are known to affect the standing crops. The farmers have erected, in order to protect the standing crop from the menace of black bucks, the farmers have erected fence with barbed cobra wire, which is creating threats to the existence of black bucks. And apart from this, there is some competition being created for the food by the stray cattle. In Punjab and Haryana, the stray cattle are increasing and they are competing with the black bucks for their fodder. Because of this, the black bucks are pushed towards the urban areas and there they face the problems of stray dogs, road accidents and other issues. Let's look into a few basics about the black buck deer. The black buck deer has geographical distribution ranging almost all over India. It's even found in peninsular part of India and the majority is found in the states of Punjab and Haryana. The habitat and ecology of black buck deer includes artificial terrestrial grasslands, deserts and forests. And there are few ecological threats being faced by these black bucks, and the ecological threats are livestock farming and ranching and hunting, trapping terrestrial animals. These are the ecological threats faced by the black bucks. Another important fact to remember is that IUCN has classified black buck as least concern. This article is about the policy bias surrounding the rainfed agriculture in India. Rainfed agriculture is practiced by majority of Indian farmers and it is having the stepmotherly treatment by the policymakers. A recent report by National Rainfed Agricultural Authority has shed light on the problems. We will have a look into that. The National Rainfed Area Authority has recently released an atlas, Rainfed Area Atlas of India. With this, they have tried to map the important rainfed agricultural areas in India, thereby providing impetus to new policy formulations. A recent study suggests that 60% of Indian farmers are dependent on rainfed agriculture, but only 1/20th of the government support is provided to the rainfed farmers. There is a skewed distribution of support from the government when comparing to the irrigated agriculture. When compared to irrigated agriculture, the rainfed agriculture is receiving a skewed support from the government. As I mentioned earlier, the government spending is 20 times lower and also the government procurement. For example, rice and wheat are cultivated in irrigated lands. And the procurement of rice and wheat during the decade 2001 to 2011 was 5.4 lakh crore. Whereas the rainfed crops like coarse cereals were procured only for 3,200 crores. This difference in procurement is also having some repercussions on the economic well-being of rainfed agriculture farmers. The third aspect is about the flagship schemes of the government. The flagship agricultural schemes of the government are focused only on irrigated lands. They are tailored not to fit the rainfed agriculture. And this has to be changed. These recommendations were provided by Ashok Dalwai, Chairman of National Rainfed Area Authority. Another fact is that he was also the chairman of the committee that was working on doubling farmers' income. The report suggests that the government should follow a balanced approach by providing same research and development focus, production support and cash incentives for both irrigated and rainfed agriculture. Now the focus of government is on providing ease of doing business. Apart from ease of doing business is more important for country's economic growth, but in order to have a sustainable development, ease of doing farming should be given more focus. This article is about the interview given by 15th Finance Commission Chairman N.K. Singh. Last year, the government constituted 15th Finance Commission. Finance Commission is a constitutional body mentioned in Article 280 of Indian Constitution, established in the year 1951 under a presidential order. What are the functions of the Finance Commission? The major functions of the Finance Commission are the distribution between the state government and the union government regarding tax revenues. The second function is to provide principles governing how the grant in aids should be distributed to the states from Consolidated Fund of India. The third is about the third level of government, how the funds should be distributed from Consolidated Fund of India to local body governments like municipalities and panchayats. These are the functions of Finance Commission. As I mentioned earlier, 15th Finance Commission was set up last year and it would be providing recommendations starting from year 2020 to 2025. Since this is the first Finance Commission after introduction of GST, impact of GST in the formula calculated by the Finance Commission would be well visible. These are the basics about the 15th Finance Commission. Before any Finance Commission is starting to work, starting to formulate new calculations, the government would be providing them with terms of reference. And one terms of reference in 15th Finance Commission was doing calculation based on 2011 census data. Distribution of revenue based on 2011 census data would be disadvantageous for the southern states because the southern states are the one who undertook population control measures proactively when comparing to the northern states. And many of the southern states have reached the total fertility ratio rate of 2.1, which means the population growth is stable in those states. If the government is to consider 2011 data, there will be skewed distribution of funds between the southern states, which is providing more tax revenue to the exchequer of central government. There was huge criticism about this move. But the recent news is that amidst the criticism, the Finance Commission is now to stick with 2011 census data for calculating the distribution of revenues. Also, the chairman N.K. Singh has provided a balancing measures. The balancing measures will try not to penalize the states that control the population growth and which has achieved a better replacement rate and demographic management. This article speaks about a new index launched by Dell Technologies. The index is titled Dell Technologies Digital Transformation Index. And based on this index, the digital maturity of the countries have been ranked. India is one of the most digitally mature country in the world. Let's see about the factors that led to this achievement of India. Economic Survey 2017-18 spoke about convergence between developing countries and developed countries. And one such area, one such avenue for convergence is digital technology. This claim is supported by the recent index released by Dell Technologies. The report of Dell Technologies Digital Transformation Index has ranked the countries based on their digital maturity. The report says that most digital mature countries are developing countries for India, Brazil and Thailand. And the least digital mature countries are Japan, Denmark and France. Dell Technologies, in collaboration with Intel and Vance & Bone, surveyed 4,600 business leaders all over the world. And based on this, they assessed the score of organizations' digital transformation efforts. By analyzing the different factors, the study revealed that the emerging market countries like India, Brazil and Thailand, as I mentioned earlier, they are most digitally mature. India topping the charts is well and good, but there are few barriers to digital transformation success in India. And the report also speaks about those barriers. What are those barriers? Those barriers are data privacy and security concerns. Of late, in the past 2 years, we have seen many news about breach of individual privacy in digital media. This has to be given a solution. This problem needs a solution and the policy initiatives should be focusing on that direction. Second is regulation and legislative changes. Introduction of new data privacy framework as suggested by Sri Krishna Committee will all fall under this barrier. The third is lack of skill sets and expertise among Indian people. There should be necessary skill upgrading and providing training to youngsters in order to upgrade their skills. Proper training should be given to youngsters of India in order to improve their adaptability to technology. Information overload in digital media is clogging the speed in which the sector is growing in India. The last is about digital governance and structure. The Indian digital governance structure is very weak comparing to the Western countries. This has to be given more importance. The report has also identified few areas for midterm investments in India. Those areas are cyber security, Internet of Things, multi-cloud environment, artificial intelligence, computer-centric approach. These all indicate a positive outlook about India's digital transformation, but there are still long way to cover by the businesses in India in order to completely utilize this potential in digital transformation. The last article is about India's effort to isolate Pakistan in SAARC. Post Pulwama attack, the government has been trying to undertake many diplomatic measures to isolate Pakistan, and one such is to isolate Pakistan in SAARC. This effort contradicts the basic ideology of SAARC. Let's have a look into that. In the aftermath of Pulwama terror attack, India has been trying to isolate Pakistan in various multilateral regional organizations. And one such sub-regional organization is SARC, South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation. This news item suggests that India's efforts to completely isolate Pakistan in SARC by temporarily or permanently suspending Pakistan from the grouping would not get support from the other members of SARC group. This is because decisions in SARC are taken unanimously and any bilateral issue between the two different member country are not discussed as part of SARC deliberation. This is one basic principle on which SARC functions on. The SARC was established in the year 1985. It comprises 8 countries: Afghanistan, Bhutan, Bangladesh, India, Maldives, Nepal, Pakistan, and Sri Lanka. There was a South Asian Free Trade Agreement signed among the SARC member countries. It was signed in the year 2004 and it came into force in the year 2006. Government of India is undertaking various punitive diplomatic actions against Pakistan in the aftermath of Pulwama attack. And one such is to restrict the trade happening between India and Pakistan, thereby giving financial loss to Pakistan. And two initiatives were taken in that angle. The first one was to withdrawal of most favored nation tag. Second is to raise import duty on Pakistan goods by 200%. These are the primary steps. And if at all India wants to oust Pakistan from SARC, Pakistan should be removed out of South Asian Free Trade Area. This needs unanimous support from other SARC member countries. Also, India is looking at a statement from SARC countries to denounce terrorism from countries in the region. Thank you.